Welcome to worship on this, our annual Memorial Sunday. I am Susan Boyer, Senior Pastor of the Laverne Church of the Brethren. I want to tell you a bit about this service. It is our tradition here to have a worship service at the end of January every year, in which we remember the members of our church family that we've lost in the previous 12 months. We have spoken their names and lit a candle for each person. This year you will see a video with all of their photos, and the music underneath it will be our ensemble singing Rain Come Down, which was written by Sean Kirchner. At the end of our Memorial Sunday service, we have had a time to come forward and light candles that represent the people in your own lives that you have lost and want to remember. It's a Sunday of love and memory, and you will be invited at the end of our service today to light candles for those you have lost. So I invite you to grab a candle or two or three or however many people you want to remember this year. It'll be your time to memorialize them. I also want to share that the two women reading scripture today are the daughters of church members that we lost this year, and I appreciate their participation. After we premiere this worship on Sunday, January 31st, we will have a fellowship Zoom time at 10 a.m. to give us a chance to speak words of love and comfort to each other. That Zoom link can be found on our website under our virtual small groups tab. I hope you join us to honor the lives of those we lost this past year. I want to share a couple announcements. You should get our monthly email tomorrow, February 1st. And since it goes out to a large group, it could end up in your spam folder. So be sure and check there if you don't see it. If you don't get our monthly email and would like to, please email us at office@lavernecob.org. We'd love to send it to you. We have a couple new virtual small groups coming this month. Amanda Bennett is leading a book study on how to raise anti-racist children. This can be for parents, grandparents, educators, and caregivers. Zandra Wagoner is leading a book study on My Grandmother's Hands, helping us to release the racism that we carry in our bodies, our blood, our nervous system. With both of these new groups, you need to order the book, so check out the website today. And I want to point out that there was going to be a group making Valentines for Woods residents who live in skilled nursing. This is a great activity for all ages. You need to sign up by tomorrow because we will be sending pre-addressed and stamped envelopes to you. You can do that by using the Jot form on the church website. I also want to say, if you are someone who lives at a distance and has found our church online, you are more than welcome to be part of these small groups. We would love to have you join us. A quick reminder to parents and youth that Christian Citizenship Seminar will be online this April and will explore the topic of economic justice. CCS is a wonderful opportunity and registration is now active. You can get there by clicking on our virtual small groups tab on our webpage. If you are new to our services and would like to know how to contribute to the mission and ministry of this church, there are a couple ways. You can mail a check to 2425 East Street, Laverne, California, 91750, or you can use the PayPal button on our church website. Please know we are grateful for your financial contributions. I invite you now to bring your grief, your broken hearts, your deep love for those you have lost, and hold them up in the light of God's love, for God is near.
Hi. I'm Beth Welch, and I'm going to be reading Psalms 34:18. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit.
Right. Hi everyone, it's Amanda here with Children's Time on this Memorial Sunday, this Sunday which may bring up a lot of emotions. Since this Sunday sometimes brings up some sad emotions, I wanted to talk to you about God and our emotions. We have a lot of feelings, don't we? Like happiness on our birthdays when we're happy and excited to open a new present or maybe play a new game or watch our favorite show. And then anger. We get mad at people sometimes, maybe because they don't share with us. And sadness, when our feelings get hurt, maybe someone says something hurtful to us, or we lose someone or something that's really important to us. We have a lot of feelings. And I want to tell you something. God wants to know all about your feelings. When we pray, Lots of times we pray for people, or maybe we thank God for things in our life, but we can also let God know how we feel. We can tell God when we're full of joy and gratitude, but we can also cry to God. We can tell God when we're angry or frustrated. We can tell God when we're confused and we don't understand. There's no emotion that God cannot handle. In fact, there's this book in the Bible called the Psalms, and there's words in it from people a long time ago. And they told God when they were happy and full of joy, and they told God when they were mad and angry and sad and brokenhearted. And so today, I encourage you, no matter how young or old you are, to know that God, our Creator, wants to hear all of your emotions, every single one.
Hi, I'm Roberta Rodriguez, daughter of Robert and Fran Rodriguez. Reading from Song of Songs, chapter 8, verse 6 and 7. Set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm. For love is strong as death, passion fierce as the grave. Its flashes are flashes of fire, a raging flame. Many waters cannot quench love, neither can floods drown it. If one offered for love all the wealth of one's house, it would be utterly scorned. Thank you.
We lost 21 members of our church family since we gathered together in our sanctuary last January for our annual Memorial Sunday. That's double how many people we usually lose in a year. Our grief is even wider. The people we lost had their pews. I could look out on a Sunday and know where each of them would be sitting. Three of the people we lost this year were members of our church staff at one time. One was a former senior pastor. Many of them were musicians and enhanced our lives through their gift and appreciation of music. They sang in the church choir, played the bells or the piano or the organ. They were people who cared about the world and the lives of their fellow human beings. Living and working in Mexico, serving with Habitat for Humanity, being present to the families of those imprisoned, serving their communities in leadership roles, and visiting and loving the sick and the lonely among us. They had some amazing stories, like being saved from a near fatal plane crash in the Yucatan jungle by a local Mayan tribe, or following a dream to become part of Major League Baseball and becoming a batting coach for the Dodgers. They were hard workers. They loved their families and their families loved them. All but one of them died after the pandemic swept in and made us safer at home and therefore unable to gather together in person to mourn their deaths. These people were ours. We were family to each other. That came home to me in a very profound way when a hospice chaplain called me to tell me of Ruth Leininger's death. She said, "I called you because you were listed as her next of kin." When we can gather again in this sanctuary, we will notice the absence of Bernie sitting up front and Bob at the back and Ruth in the cutout pew she claimed. We will miss John's deep voice in the choir and Larry in the bell choir and the smile on Florence's face that went from ear to ear. We'll miss Leola's blue eyes that sparkled with delight as she recounted a story, and Millie reaching out to all new people with love and welcome. The losses of this past year are tangible for us as a congregation. While we have named and remembered the saints of our church in this service, I am also very aware that many, many of you have lost family and friends who weren't part of this congregation. You've lost grandparents, children, siblings, aunts, uncles, spouses, students, co-workers, and beloved friends. More than ever, we are aware of the loss of our unnamed brothers and sisters around this globe, because every time we turn on the television, there is a sidebar keeping us current on the number of deaths in the United States and the world due to COVID-19. Over 2 million people now. Families have had to navigate the long list of impersonal details that follow a death with all the further complications of a deadly virus. They've had to make an appointment with the bank, meet the attorney outside, spend hours on the phone, figure out how to clean out a home without being together, wait for a death certificate or cremation or burial as mortuaries navigate a backlog of deaths. And then they must decide as a family whether they'll plan an online memorial service or wait until they can gather again in person. And for many families, death followed weeks or months of trying to find care for their loved ones or being shut out of hospital rooms or holding up love notes through the windows of a skilled nursing center. They were forced to say goodbye to family members without being able to hold them, touch them, whisper love into their ears. And with every death, we've had to relive the griefs of our own individual lives. I have walked through the loss of my husband over and over and over again this year, as I've lived alone without human contact. We are weary of death and loss and grief. We are weary of staying away from each other so as not to cause further death and loss and grief. We could spend hours recounting and reliving the pain of all of the death we've witnessed. Our sorrows are so deep this year we could fall into the crevasse of sadness and never crawl out. It feels important to name it and speak our lament. We will be processing our anguish for years to come, healing from its reality and its heartache. It's important we grieve. It's important we do not voice false comfort or unthinking platitudes or encourage someone to hurry up and be okay or tell them it could be worse. We must sit in our discomfort and feel the ache. It is the price of love. Love is why we grieve. Love, it's there, always there, at the base of our mourning. As I pastor, it is in the depths of death and dying that I have witnessed the most beautiful testaments of love. It is death's palpable and tangible companion. I have witnessed love's presence, longevity, tenderness, resilience, cohesion, and fierceness as I have walked with families and accompanied the dying. I have seen it for myself in my own loss. Love is the most consistent reality through all of it. I share with you a story from this past year, with permission. About 3 weeks before Bernie Pence died, I gathered with her husband and children and had an anointing service. And by gather, I mean we gathered through FaceTime. One of her children joined from Spain in what had to have been a very late hour. We all wished we could be in the same room, but what we experienced was no less real, no less sacred. You could feel the love, you could see it, hear it, touch it. Bernie spoke of her life, describing each place that they had lived, each child they had birthed. She shared memories of each of her children. Then all four of her children spoke to her of what she had taught them. Jerry, her husband of 72 years, shared how grateful he was for his family. He said to Bernie, "It has been wonderful to be your husband. We have so much to be proud of, so much to be thankful for. It's a wonderful life." When we finished anointing her and praying, Bernie just spontaneously began to sing, "Amen, amen." Everybody joined, "Amen, amen, amen." Sometimes I witness something so beautiful, so full of heart, so real, so sacred, so loving. I can't put words to it. All I can do is recount the story. Today, Roberta, one of Fran Rodriguez's children, read our scripture from Song of Songs. "For love is as strong as death, passion as fierce as the grave. Waters cannot quench love, floods cannot drown it." I thought of this scripture as I sat with the Pence family that night. Death is an ending. It feels decisive and permanent, and yet it is no match for love. Death does not conquer love. Death does not end the love you felt or continue to feel coming back to you. I remember several months after my husband died, my oldest son called me and he said, "I was looking into the mirror this morning and I felt Dad's presence. It wasn't because I look like my father," he said. "It was more than that. I knew with certainty that he still sees me and loves me." And in his words, I heard the words of the poet Munia Khan, "I will keep on loving you until eternity makes me love you more." My dear friends, please don't let the trauma of this past year keep you from dwelling in the love that will not let you go. You are immersed in it. Love is wide and deep and unending. There is a foreverness in our loving and being loved. We are absolutely enveloped, encased in love. Hold on to that truth, for I believe that just as nothing can separate us from the love of God, nothing can separate us from the love we have shared with those who have passed on before us. We carry that love in our bodies, in our memories, in the love we pass on to those who carry on after we leave this world. This love just keeps getting passed on until eternity makes it grow ever larger. Amen.
When we have gathered together in the sanctuary for past memorial services, you were invited to come forward to light candles for the saints in your lives, for the special people you have loved and want to remember. Today, while we can't yet gather together physically, we can still participate in this act of prayer, the spiritual practice of candle lighting. Together as community gathered in spirit, we will participate in the sanctifying act of remembering. I invite you to light your candle now. Through the lighting of these candles, O God, we hold each other and wrap ourselves in the memory and presence of love that never dies. Amen.
And when I rise, let me rise up like a bird without regret, joyfully. And when I fall, let me fall down like a leaf without regret, gratefully. And when I rise, let me
go in love, gratefully, joyfully, fiercely. Trade nothing for love. Hold on to it for dear life. And when life ends, rest in the assurance that love grows ever larger. Amen.